Arguably, the most important theorem I will tell you about is the Cook-Levin theorem. It states that satisfiability is NP complete. Satisfiability was the first natural problem to be shown to be NP complete. And this is why the Cook-Levin theorem is so important, because it establishes for the first time that there are natural NP complete problems. Once we have one such problem, we can easily show for further problems that they are NP complete. We only need to do reductions. To establish that a problem X is NP complete, from scratch, we would have to show that every problem in NP polynomial time car produces to X. So this is what we would have to do in the Cook-Levin theorem, for example, for satisfiability. But once we have one NP-complete problem, it turns out that this becomes much simpler. Once we know that satisfiability is NP-complete, for example, we can easily show that some other problem X is NP-complete by reducing satisfiability to it using a polynomial time carp reduction. So instead of having to show that every problem in NP reduces to X, we actually only have to show that one problem, say satisfiability, reduces to X. We will discuss all this in greater detail later separately. For now, it's just important that you understand that establishing for the first problem that it's NP complete is much harder than establishing it for additional problems further down the line. So the Cook-Levin theorem is sort of a bootstrapping theorem, which kickstarts this entire process of establishing NP completeness for many, many, many more problems. Establishing completeness for the first natural problem in a complexity class is also known as a master reduction. So, how could we prove such a powerful theorem? Well, we know that the first step for establishing NP completeness should really be to show that satisfiability is contained in NP, but we already know that, we've already discussed that. So let's move straight to the second point. We have to take any problem in NP and polynomial time can't reduce it to satisfiability. The difficulty here is that we do not know a lot about the problems we have to reduce from. The only fact we know is that they are in NP. Because we do not know anything further than that about these problems, the only thing we can use in our proof is the definition of NP itself. We know that a problem is contained in NP if we have a polynomial time certifier for that problem. So when we want to reduce a problem X to satisfiability in polynomial time, we look at the certifier for that problem X. That's a Turing machine. And what we will aim to do is the following. We will take this certifier, this Turing machine, and we construct a Boolean formula. And this Boolean formula should have the property that it's satisfiable if and only if there is a certificate that makes the certifier accept. And otherwise, the Boolean formula should not be satisfiable. And if we would manage to do something like that, we have some hope of getting a reduction, because then a word is in the language X if and only if this Boolean formula is satisfiable. And that's exactly what we need for our reduction. So let's try to make this idea a bit more specific. As an input, we have X, and we want to know whether X is in our language or not. And we also have this polynomial time certifier, this Turing machine. Taking these things, we want to construct a Boolean formula. And the variables that this formula uses correspond to the bit string X, we can just interpret the bit string of length n to correspond to n Boolean variables, say x1 to xn. And also we have variables for the certificate. So we know that the length of the certificate is polynomially bounded. So say the length of the certificate is at most p of size of x for some polynomial function p. So we would have a further p of size of x many variables in our formula. Call them t1 to tp of x. And now our goal is that this formula phi that we construct should somehow capture the computation that the Turing machine, this certifier, does. So if the Turing machine accepts this input x and t, then the formula phi should be satisfied for x and t. And if the Turing machine rejects, then the formula should be false. Right? So the formula would exactly capture what the output of the Turing machine for this input x and t is. If we could manage to construct a formula like this, then our reduction would be done. What we would do is the following. We have x, so we plug in the correct values for all the x variables in the formula. We hard code this into the formula. But we leave the t variables as free variables that still can be chosen. And then we check whether that formula is satisfiable. If it is, it means there's impossible truth assignment to the t variables such that the formula is satisfied, meaning there is a choice for t such that the certifier accepts the input xt. And therefore we know that x is in the language. On the other hand, if the formula is not satisfiable, we know that no matter what values we give to the t variables, the formula is not satisfied. And therefore the Turing machine, the certifier, would reject. And that means we can conclude that the word is not in the language. This would complete our reduction. We have a formula phi, which is satisfiable if and only if the word x is in the language. Unfortunately, though, it is quite difficult to see how to construct such a formula directly. So we will do something that is seemingly a bit more complicated. So far, our idea has been to construct a Boolean formula that captures the output behavior of our Turing machine, of our certifier. But what we will actually do is we will construct a formula that in some sense simulates the entire computational path that the Turing machine takes. So it takes account for what the Turing machine does from one step to the next, all the way until we reach a terminating state. And our formula will be constructed in such a way that it somehow ensures that each computational step really does follow from the previous step. So each step is a valid continuation of the previous steps. Turing machines are quite simple devices, but they still have some complexities. We have the contents of the tape, we have the head position, and we have the internal state. So our next goal is to remove one of those complexities and essentially get rid of this head position complication. So we will have a simpler machine which will be easier to capture in a Boolean formula. This simpler machine is called an oblivious Turing machine, and it has a nice property that the head movement is independent of the input. It only depends on the input size, but it does not depend on the bits in the input. I will explain how oblivious Turing machines work and why we can use them instead of standard Turing machines in a separate video.